Okay guys, so I'm going to be talking about Nickl. So Nickl is our new query language. Couchbase is a database, it's a distributed database. Distributed anything is a difficult problem. So distributed databases keeps us very busy. And we started looking back at the history of databases, and we realized that one of the reasons why relational databases have been so successful is because they had a domain-specific language, SQL, which really took away how from what, and that made relational databases successful. We wanted to take a page out of that book, and we wrote a query language. It's called Nickl. So let's start off by looking backwards. You know, databases change very slowly, and so the perspective is not in years, but in decades. What is data? You know, there's facts all around us. You know, this room probably has 2,000 lumens of lighting. Your pulse rate is probably 72. The temperature is probably 24 degrees. So there are a lot of facts around us. And facts have been around forever. You know, when dinosaurs lived, facts still existed. What has changed is that humans observe more facts. Dinosaur probably didn't care about the lumen level in a room. There were no rooms in its cave, perhaps. But we do. So what has changed in the recent years is that more and more facts are being observed. And this is what we call as data. You know, data is not about tables and columns. People think of databases as tables and columns, but that's not the nature of data. Data are facts that we observe, and a database is an electronic record of that. So you have facts, you observe them, that becomes data, and you capture them, that becomes a database. So that is the very fundamental nature of data. And let's see what has been happening. So, you know, a decade ago, I'm old enough, you see all the white hair, I can talk about a decade ago. So a decade ago, databases looked something like this. You take an invoice. An invoice to most people is a piece of paper. It says where the order was shipped to, how much it costed, and it has all the items that were shipped. So it's a piece of paper. But in a database, it was represented as a series of tables, and there were foreign key relationships. And to basically get an object that you recognized, you had to do a lot of joins. And to save it back into the database, you had to do a lot of decompositions. And so there was an impedance mismatch between the real world and what databases stored. What has been happening over the recent years is that we are starting to capture more and more data. We don't just capture invoices, but we capture people's preferences. You know, preference is not a very well-defined thing. You know, people say, I like something. I like it only on Wednesdays. You know, different people have different ways of doing things. So once we say we're going to capture a human element like preference, it becomes very difficult to describe what it is. It becomes even more difficult to write a table, a schema, to hold it. And then we have travel itineraries. It involves various elements. There are flights, there are lost baggages, there are ships, there are people you meet, there's meals to have, there are preferences, food choices. So when you talk of a travel itinerary, it has many, many components to it, and it's very difficult to say that here is a table or here's a schema that defines someone's travel itinerary. And we have something like credit cards. Credit cards are reasonably easy. You can fit it in a table, unlike a travel itinerary. And you have things like video and you have crowdsourcing. So two things have happened. One is data as we recognize it is getting more and more varied. So it's becoming difficult to shoehorn it into a table. It's difficult to characterize anything about it. So the notion that you have a schema and a table is becoming, is basically slowing things down. And it has exploded. Every passing year, we observe more and more data. So, you know, probably 10 years ago, recording a program on a VCR was an expensive proposition. Today you look at all the closed circuit TVs, right? They probably hold everything that happened for a year. So data has exploded. But relational databases have scaling constraints. They're not able to handle the vast amount of data that's being collected today. So here is where Nickl comes in. So we have the basic data model of the past, which was relational. It tried to model relations between data. There were flat tables, and you use tables as building blocks. but in the process you spent a lot of time putting them together. There's rigidity in data, which is a good thing because you want your data to be predictable, but it also prevented you from evolving your applications. You model to technology. In other words, no one thinks of tables and columns in their head. Well, maybe once, few of you, but you know, you take the average guy off the street, he won't think in terms of tables and columns. So by having tables and columns exposed to application developers, we were modeling to technology. Technology was not modeling people. And there's the application impedance. You spent a lot of time getting data in and out. And the key strength was the query language, SQL. I'm sure you guys all know about SQL. It's a declarative language which lets you tell what you want without telling how to fetch it. And it's a very powerful concept. What Couchbase is introducing is NQL, which is a query language for rich data model, as we call it. So we work with documents, not with tables and columns. We allow rich objects. So you can have two objects in the natural form. An invoice is a single item. It's not a collection of tables. And we model relationships between them. We allow flexible data. You can have data that says invoice that has bill to address. And tomorrow, your bill to address can become an array if you're shipping to multiple locations. So we relax the constraint of having each of them to resemble the other. And we model business. And OK, this is our sales talk, sales slide. So, but this is the new language, very interesting. And there's a reason why we call it N1QL. We basically say that it's not first normal form. So what we have done is we have taken SQL, which is basically a domain-specific language that people know and understand has been proven over the last many years. We have added the ability to deal with JSON and rich data. Because JSON is very flexible and it's effectively a tagging language, you can represent any data that you have. And we have taken the notion of composites. So we are not even in first normal form. So you can have multi-valued attributes. And the essential work that we have done at Couchbase is to take SQL and extend it to a schema that is not in first normal form. So we had to go back and visit some of the roots of the relational theory and try to fit it into our new language, NQL, which is what we have. I'll quickly run through this, the parts that do look like SQL. You know, we have select, distinct, where, order by, all the stuff that you're familiar with. We have nulls, we have pattern matching, all the stuff you expect from a database. We have create indexes, we have high-performance distributed indexes. We have data manipulation language. So all the things you would expect from a SQL database. And we have taken new artifacts to deal with the richness of data. We allow multi-valued attributes, as I said, so we don't assume it's in first normal form. We allow nest and unnest. We basically add the ability to do array searches, deep traversal. We actually correct one of the historic wrongs in SQL, which is to treat null and missing as similar. So we have null and missing as two separate entities in the database. And we allow key value access. So we have added extensions to deal with the richness of data. And here is how it looks like. So it's a distributed database. Some nodes run indexes, some nodes run query. Some nodes hold our KV data. It's hash partitioned. And the indexes are range partitioned, and you can choose how you partition them. This is our query processing pipeline. It goes through the usual phases of parsing, planning, scanning, fetching, and the works. This is our indexing pipeline where we basically take hash partition data and make it into range partitions. And we deal with consistency timestamps because in a distributed database, consistency is a difficult concept. Let's get to Go, right? So Go started very organically at Couchbase. At Couchbase, we use Erlang, we use C, we use C++, we use Ruby, we use Python. Somebody wanted to add a new language to it, and the general approach is that, you know, we have too many languages already, we don't want one more. Because we are open source firm and we are relatively independent, we don't have a lot of mandates. So people use what they want. And when you're starting a project, you typically pick a language that best suits you. So we have ended up with a lot of languages, and now we are trying to collapse them to fewer ones. So the initial approach to using Go was, oh no, we don't want one more runtime, one more language in the mix. But what happened was that Go's productivity is something that speaks for itself. So a project started in Go. Marty wrote Nickel's first version. It was very successful. So Go kind of grew organically in the company. It wasn't a top-down decision. We have this discussion all the time saying what is the next language we should choose. And Go was not one of them. Go happened because developers wanted it. They wrote code and the code did well. And so Go established itself from a very bottoms-up perspective. And you know, if you look at the last 10 years, there has not been many languages which have come into mission-critical applications or mission-critical parts of a server. You have Java. Java was probably the last language that made a big impact on server code. You know, you take Rust, excellent language. You know, it has a lot of new ways of approaching, very nice to use. But you don't see a lot of server code running Rust today. We run Erlang, but that's been a problem for us because it's very difficult to maintain a VM that is not widely used. So Go is basically what I see as the next iteration in server languages. And here is why, right? So one is the developer point of view, and as all the talks have demonstrated, developers love it. There's the business side of it, which I want to present to you here. So I had the opportunity for my team to write a very similar component in C++ and Go. You could say it's fortunate because I got to see the same component being written in two different languages, and it's unfortunate because we had to do the same thing twice. But it gave me a very valuable perspective of how Go compares to C in a commercial setting and in a high-performance server. And here is what it turned out, right? So this particular component, when it was coded in C++, took us a little more than 200 days to build. The same thing written in Go took us about 150 days. You may expect this to be much lower based on your personal experiences with Go. But we have certain constraints. We don't want to use a lot of external projects because we want to control our code and be reasonably familiar and be able to support all of it. And we also, the programmers were themselves not comfortable with Go, so they were also learning as they went along. But despite those two limitations, it still managed to beat C++ in time to build. So if you are working with deadlines, which all of us do, Go is offering a very, very real benefit, which is that it takes less time to build a given application. The second is the error rate. You know, bugs are a fact of life and a very painful fact of life, software engineer's life. And I went back and looked how many bugs did this particular project generate. The version that was written in C++, we had roughly about 400 bugs. And the version that was written in Go was basically around 250 bugs. So, you know, there are a lot of metrics, and I'm not a big fan of software metrics because software is like a painting rather than an engineering skill at some day. But I thought this is reasonably representative of my personal experience with Go, where you can write more lines of code and have fewer bugs that come out of it. So two very strong strengths of Go. It's faster to build, and you make less mistakes doing so. And, you know, this is why I think Go will be the next big language. That in the server world. So I'll quickly go over a couple of other points. System performance analysis, we are still underway. So we really don't know how it behaves when run as a server component. We have done some benchmarks, and Go compares favorably with C++ and Java. This is with the caveat that, you know, we really didn't take into account garbage collection issues. So if you were to look at just plain code that's running, you know, in iteratively, we see that it's reasonably comparable with C++ and Java. And an interesting observation we made in the process was that to get Go code to run well, we didn't have to take a lot of effort. But with C++, we had to do with, you know, mess around with different libraries. We tried Boost, we tried STD libraries. And so we had to pick and fine tune before we could get good performance. And with Java, there was a whole bunch of parameters that we had to optimize, like the min heap size and things like that. But Go performed well out of the box. We compiled the program and ran it, and it ran well. One of the awesome aspects of Go is binary generation. When you work with large projects, you have all the DLLs, you have dependencies, you have header files. Go throws all that away, as you know. And it is a huge relief, you know, if you are managing a large project. you spend probably, you know, quarter of your time dealing with dependencies and DLLs and how they run an operating system. And that made sense in a day when, you know, internet was slow and downloading large programs didn't make sense. And your disks were small, so you wanted to reuse libraries. But that's all gone away today. Who cares about disk space and who cares about internet download speeds? They're really fast that it doesn't make sense to reuse libraries just for the space aspect of it. So a statically linked executable is a step forward. We have come a full circle. This is what it used to be a long time ago. And then libraries came along as the next step forward. And now we come back to statically linked executables. This is a major saving in time and effort. And the VM in double quotes, the library, runtime library rather, is reasonably stable. We haven't encountered any major problems. And it says a lot about a new language to have a stable VM. So the weaknesses of Go that we noticed is that dependency management is overly optimistic. You say import github.com/foo/bar. You are basically making an assumption that repository is stable and the latest version of code there will work with the latest version of your code. It never happens as we know. So we had to go through a lot of trouble to kind of fight with the Go's dependency management. We use Google repo and we basically don't use Go get. And I think this is one weakness because any significant project will want to control versions in a more predictable manner. The IDE and debugger are still primitive. The things that you could do with Eclipse and Java code, you know, Go is quite not there yet. You end up doing a lot of manual changes that could have been automated. GDB works okay with Go, but you know, it's definitely not what you see in other languages like C or C++. Especially when you start compiling and linking with C Go, it gets a lot more difficult because, you know, if your C code seg faults, you do need a debugger. And for example, on Windows, I haven't really found a good way to debug C Go code with Go binaries. There are garbage collector issues predictably. Anytime you take a garbage collected language and put it in a server, garbage collector will be a bottleneck. And predictably, we are having the same problems with Go. What we did was we wrote what is textbook code. We didn't put any effort to optimize you know, garbage generation or do anything out of the way. And we see that we are generating a lot of garbage. So we now have to start optimizing for it. We might have to allocate blocks of memory and manage it ourselves. The downside is that this makes it a little more complex. So it takes more time and effort. But the good thing is, unlike Java, Go does not actively try to prevent you from doing so. You know, if you wanted to manage your own block of memory in Java, it's extremely painful. And basically, Java tries hard to prevent you from doing that. But Go is not like that. It doesn't help you do it, but it doesn't come in your way either. So it is possible, and we have a slab allocator that one of our colleagues wrote that we are planning to use. How am I doing on time? Oh, okay. That's good. So we can do some questions, and if time permits, I can do a demo of the language.